Chapter 9. Imam Ali, peace be with him's tradition and the theory of ethical relativism. Our discussion is about the question of relativity of morality, and by extension, the relativity of education. According to the theory which holds that morality is relative and varies in different periods and places for different individuals, we cannot present a single moral scheme for all people for all times, and any moral scheme advanced by any school of thought, whether Islam or other schools, must be confined to a particular place, time, and circumstances, and naturally a different scheme must be observed in another place. At this point, we should say that morality and behavior are not identical. Morality, which is a set of acquired qualities, traits, and dispositions, which are accepted by man as moral principles, or a psychological paradigm on the basis of which the human soul must be molded, is something immutable, absolute, universal, and timeless. However, human behavior, which is the outward actualization of the same dispositions, varies, and must vary under various circumstances. In other words, the manifestations or embodiments of man's morality vary in different situations. At a certain place, one must behave in a certain way and in a different way at another place. It is not that one must be such and such at a certain place and such at another place. For us to say that one must be such and such at every period and such at every place is much different from saying that one must have such a lofty personality to be such at all places, but have different manifestations of his behavior in different periods. Presenting an objection. Someone may possibly say that there are injunctions in Islam regarding the dispositions of man and woman. Some dispositions which are laudable for men are presented as blameworthy for women. On the contrary, other dispositions which are laudable for women are presented as blameworthy for men. Is the moral paragon for men different from that for women from the Islamic perspective? That is, in terms of humanity, are they of different kinds? Does Islam suggest two distinct molds for their souls? In terms of what we call disposition, should women be molded in a certain way and men in another way? If it is so, then it is clear that the foundation of the notion that disposition is an immutable and absolute matter is untenable and it has no basis at all. The primary proof is that it differentiates man from woman. There is a statement in the Peak of Eloquence, or Nahjul Balagha, from Imam Ali, peace be with him, which may be possibly advanced by someone else. It thus states, "The best traits of women are those which are the worst traits of men." That is, the best dispositions and qualities of women are the worst for men. The things which are the best of dispositions for women are the worst for men. Three qualities are mentioned: vanity, cowardice, and miserliness. We know that arrogance is described as a very bad quality, and it is even psychologically considered an illness. As it is obvious, cowardice is a kind of weakness and incapability. Miserliness, meanwhile, denotes love of wealth and property. They are the worst qualities for men, while it is stated in Nahjul Balagha that they are the best qualities for women, and that women must possess them. How could it be? Imam Ali, peace be with him, then gives an explanation that answers this question, stating, "Thus, since woman is vain, she will not allow anyone access to herself. In other words, she draws a line of separation between her and any unrelated man." Then, going on to say, "And since she is miserly, she will preserve her own property and the property of her husband. And since she is weak-hearted, she will be frightened with everything that befalls her." Reply. Let me say something at the outset. You may think that I want to say that this hadith is not strong or authentic, but it is not so. We have to know first the real meaning and implication of this statement and what the Imam, peace be with him, wanted to say. Secondly, does it conform to other teachings of Islam, and do his words in that statement have internal harmony? The preliminary point I would like to highlight is as follows. Literary scholars, and other scholars as well, have an expression which denotes that in Arabic terminology related to the psychological states of man, sometimes a word is used not on account of that particular psychological state, but on account of the effect which is usually expressed by that state. For example, kindness is a psychological, emotional state of man. Sometimes this word is used to refer to that state itself, and there are also other times when it is used to refer to an outward expression of it, whether kindness really exists in it or not. We say that so-and-so is kind to so-and-so. That is, the former does something which is an expression of kindness, regardless of whether there is really kindness involved or not. Moreover, the same human expression is used in relation to God. Although such expressions in their human sense do not apply to God, they are applicable in the sense of their effect. We say, for instance, in Surah Baqarah, or chapter 2, verse 15, it is Allah who derides them. Or we say that God is ashamed of such a thing. Haya, or modesty, or to be ashamed of, is applied to man and it expresses a human feeling. For the human being, haya is the state of shame, shyness, bashfulness, blushing, and disgrace. It is a psychological state. Undoubtedly, haya means to be ashamed, a psychological state which a person experiences. Thus, to be disgraced and bashful is not appropriate for God. Sometimes, however, what God does to his servant seems to be a state stemming from shame and shyness. So it is said that God is ashamed of. In the preface of Gulistan, Sa'adi says, "When a sinful servant, conscious of his guilt, lifted up the hands of repentance in hope of obtaining pardon at the court of justice, the glorious and sublime being, the Almighty, regarded him not. Again he supplicated and was again disregarded. Once more he prayed with humility and sorrow, and then the just God finally said, 'O my angels, indeed I am ashamed of my servant who has no other providence than myself, and therefore verily I do pardon him. I have heard his prayer and have granted his petition because I am ashamed of the excessive supplication and sorrow of my servant.'" Similarly, derision or istihza from a human perspective is a psychological state with an outward manifestation. But when God does something to a person such that he is like someone, a subject of derision, it is said that Allah derides him. It is not limited to God. In many other cases, the same terminology is applied to many other cases, such as those of human beings, but it is because of the behavior which is usually caused by the said state. How? Three terms are mentioned here: vanity, cowardice, and miserliness. It is clear that vanity in itself is a psychological state of a person. Before giving the meaning of the following tradition, I shall mention to you its context. We are told, arrogance with the arrogant is a form of worship. It means that if a person behaves arrogantly, you should not behave in such a way that encourages him to be arrogant. Instead, you have to behave arrogantly with an arrogant person so as to embarrass him and discourage him from arrogance. This statement that arrogance with the arrogant is a form of worship does mean that arrogance in itself as a psychological state is self-admiration and self-conceitedness is praiseworthy, and if you encounter an arrogant person, you must also truly be self-conceited. Instead, the tradition wants to say that your state of being must always be humble, but you must behave arrogantly with an arrogant person so as to humiliate him. Thus, arrogance with the arrogant as a character is not encouraged. What is enjoined is arrogance as a behavior similar to that of an arrogant person. The Prophet's order in Umrat al-Qadha. Umrat al-Qadha, or lapsed Umrah, was the Umrah performed by the Holy Prophet, peace be with him, and his progeny in Mecca in the 7th year after Hijrah, after the Treaty of Hudaybiyah. The circumstance surrounding the treaty was that the unbelievers did not allow the Prophet to enter Mecca, and the Prophet encamped near Mecca with the condition that he could enter a year later, and he did. Yet to be governed by Islam, Mecca was ruled by hostile unbelievers. According to the treaty, the Muslims were permitted to come. However, in order not to be wrongly identified as Muslims, And so the non-Muslims could not observe the Muslims and probably be influenced by them. There was a public order for residents to vacate all houses in Mecca and temporarily stay outside the city, where they could not in any way see the Muslims who were supposed to stay in Mecca for the Umrah for 3 days, as stipulated in the treaty. When the Muslims entered Mecca, the Quraysh tribe, men, women, and children, went outside the city, but just on top of the surrounding mountains, specifically on the nearby slopes. The Holy Prophet, peace be with him, and his progeny, knew that they were observing the Muslims from a distance. He ordered the Muslims to wear the garb of ihram on one of their shoulders, and to do the running in a dignified and honorable manner while circumambulating, or tawaf, of the Kaaba. This was the first tawaf ever performed during the time of the Prophet, peace be with him, and his progeny. When they performed it, it was as if they were on a battlefront, so that the unbelievers would see them in a state of power and glory. This is while the time was a time of worship and the state was a state of supplication, entreating, and humility. At that time, however, the Holy Prophet wanted the Muslims to behave magnanimously, not arrogantly. He did not want them to be actually arrogant. As another example, we are told to behave pompously on the battlefield, that is, to walk elegantly and stylishly like an arrogant person. After killing the prominent enemy, Amr, during the Battle of the Trench, when returning back to the Muslims from the battle arena, the commander of the faithful, Imam Ali, peace be with him, walked slowly and outwardly, showed himself to be elegant and arrogant. The Holy Prophet said, "This way of making steps is hated by Allah, except at this time." This is another arrogant facade, but Islam abhors arrogance by itself on the battlefield, not at all times. None of those who are expert in the jurisprudence of tradition has said that arrogance itself as a quality trait in psychological state takes exception by stating, for example, that it is good in the battlefield and bad somewhere else. It is good here and bad there. Arrogance in these cases means arrogant behavior. Even here, regarding women, on the basis of the part of the tradition that she will not allow anyone access to herself, it is never suggested that it is good for a woman to be arrogant, even with other women. A woman must not be arrogant with fellow women. How about with her nearest of kin, her husband, her father, her brother, paternal uncle, or maternal uncle? It is obvious that she must also not be arrogant with them. Man cannot have two opposite traits at the same time. One is either arrogant or not arrogant. The tradition in question states that a woman must behave with vanity with a non-mahram man. Of course, the word zah, or vanity, which is used here is somewhat different from takabbur, arrogance. That is, her attitude must be dignified. The humility and humbleness, for example, of man toward another man or a woman toward another woman, or a woman toward a mahram man, are correct. It is unexpected or inconvenient for a woman to be too open to a non-mahram, as this lowers her dignity. In dealing with a non-mahram man, a woman must be watchful of her gestures. Thus, it is stated in the tradition that if a woman behaves in such a manner with a non-mahram man, the latter will observe a boundary between him and her. Hence, this takabbur is related to behavior and not to trait. The tradition itself shows that if a woman behaves this way, she will not allow a non-mahram man to have access to her. We have always stated the principle that Islam generally wants to have limits between man and woman, practically, like what is said about covering, as well as morally, like what is said about these cases. And these limits prevent the flame of ardor, whose danger has always been there. Therefore, this is quote-unquote arrogant behavior and not arrogance per se. The concept of jabn, or cowardice, in this tradition. Let us proceed on the issue of cowardice, or jabn. The issue of jabn here also pertains to the issue of woman's modesty and not to the issue of cowardice and bravery per se. Bravery as a psychological quality, which is commonly known as strength of the heart, lack of fear and refusal to surrender to others, is praiseworthy for both men and women. Islam never says that it is good for a man to be brave and hard-hearted and for a woman to be coward. Why? It is because, first of all, whatever we have concerning the merit of bravery and the demerit of cowardice, which is plenty, is not exclusive to men or women as it pertains to both of them. Second, the record of Muslim women shows that they have been always brave. That is, brave Muslim women have received distinct honor and recognition because bravery means a lack of fear and anxiety. A brave person who is in danger does not think of life or wealth and withdraws from worldly concern to perform self-sacrifice. That person is ready to give up life, possessions, and position to face the enemy. The story of Safiya bint Abdul Muttalib. We can read, for instance, in the history of Islam, the story of Safiya, as an epic story worthy of praise and in accordance with what is expected from a Hashmi lady. During the Battle of the Trench, the Muslims were besieged by the unbelievers. The Holy Prophet, peace be with him, and his progeny ordered all women to gather in a specific place. There was a man named Hassan ibn Thabit, who was also called a muflik, or a poet. That is, he was one of the leading poets who rendered great service to Islam. He was also a mukhadram poet. He was a poet during the pre-Islamic period of ignorance, jahiliyyah, as well as during the period of Islam. He was a high-ranking Arab poet. Like most poets, and those whose profession is speaking and whose energy is mostly spent in speaking, he was incompetent in physical action. At that time, when war was imposed upon them, he left the battlefront and hid among the women. Incidentally, one of the enemies came, and when he learned that women were occupying the said fortress, he immediately attacked it. The woman said to Hassan, "Rise up and take a sword to face the enemy." But he did not do so. Like others, he covered himself with a veil and went to the back to hide himself. Here, the women were no longer expected to hide their bravery. Safiya came to the front like a man. She brandished a sword and fatally struck the enemy. Another instance was the bravery of Hazrat Zahra or Hazrat Zainab, peace be with them both. We can observe that in terms of power and strength of the heart, having an epic-making spirit and showing no fear in facing death, Hazrat Zainab is an extremely good example of Islam. And in the history of Islam, her account has always been mentioned as a perfect example. When it is said that women should be cowardly, it means that her action must be timid and circumspect. It is not about fear for life or fear for wealth and possessions, but rather about fear in relation to modesty. A courageous person has no fear, he says. I shall go to the battlefront, and at most I will be killed, and if ever I get killed, it is with honor. Women must be also like that as far as getting killed is concerned. But in a situation when her modesty is in danger, that is, there is danger that her modesty will be tarnished, there is no room for bravery, because bravery means self-sacrifice. And if she displays bravery in this case, that means to say, I shall go without any consideration for my modesty. Modesty is not something personal such that one can be told, disregard it so that you will not be considered selfish. Modesty is something which is entrusted to you. This is like the case of a person who is entrusted with a valuable item, and her duty is to deliver the said valuable item to its owner and to display her bravery along the way. Instead of spending all her efforts to deliver the item, she jeopardizes it. Mr. Humayun once cited a good and instructive example. He said, 45 years ago, I saw a porter carrying a big tray with items made from semi-vitrified porcelain, which could rarely be found even among royal families or dignitaries and nobles, and are among the precious articles of a country. On his head, he would go from one house to another. Some troublemakers realized it was a good opportunity to annoy him, and they did. I pitied him and said, now this person will get angry and throw this tray of porcelain products as a way of defending himself, and all these items will be broken. Yet I saw that he was able to endure the situation, knowing what load he was carrying. It was not the time for bravery and defending oneself, it was the time to preserve the trust. He realized the value of patience. The woman as carrier of human trust. As a possessor of modesty, the woman is the carrier of an enormous human trust, and not the owner of a personal item, such that if she relinquishes it, she deprives only herself. Relinquishing it is tantamount to refusal to discharge a human trust. Man must be modest, so must woman. But we know that even if the world is filled with the slogan of equality of man and woman, no one can make man and woman identical to each other. And there is no doubt that man and woman are of different genders that are equal in some matters and qualitatively different from each other in other matters. As such, woman's modesty is something which can be violated by man. In today's world, we also hear from Europe and America that some men molest women. Essentially, the position of woman is different from that of men, and woman can never trample upon the modesty of men. It is men who can trample upon a woman's chastity. You can always see a couple of boys caught in front of a girls' high school for annoying 100 students. Yet, have you seen so far, and is it possible that a few girls would come to a high school for boys and annoy the students? Attacks on modesty are always done by men, and it is the woman who must be the foremost guardian and protector of this social, moral, and human trust. This tradition, which gives admonition only to the woman to behave timidly, does not say to behave in that way with another woman, her husband, relatives, and the like, wherein modesty or chastity is not an issue. Rather, it refers to woman dealing with a non-mahram man with regards to modesty and chastity. For a woman, it is not brave to say, I would pass by a group of men alone and nothing will happen to me. I am brave and not afraid of anything. Bravery means not to be afraid of giving sacrifice. That is, if the trust is taken from her, she would say, I will offer sacrifice. But if your chastity is violated and you do not give sacrifice, it follows that you are not faithful to the trust. Therefore, the issue of cowardice or jabn, which is encouraged by the Commander of the Faithful, peace be with him, for woman, means that her behavior must be timid, but not in the absolute sense, not at the time when there is danger to her life, her property, or social dignity, but rather in a situation when there is danger to her modesty or chastity. It is an admonition for women to be cautious. The concept of bukhl in this tradition. So is the issue of bukhl, or miserliness. The Quran states in Surah Hashr, chapter 59, verse 9, and those who are saved from their own greed, it is they who are felicitous. The Quran labels a certain state as shuhi nafs. It means obstruction in the self or worship of money. That is, for a person to have such a state that taking a coin away from that person is like having part of that person's life taken away. In Islam, which is the religion of monotheism, Islam, which wants to uproot human attachments and does not want the human being, man or woman, to be attached to anything other than God, is there any such probability that in accordance with the tradition in question, for example, Hazrat Zahra, peace be with her, would be enjoined thus that it is good for you to be obsessed with money and riches? So why would Hazrat Zahra, peace be with her, come and give even her wedding gown in the way of God, and it would be considered in Islam a great virtue? And it is indeed a great virtue. The miserliness referred to in this tradition is not miserliness regarding individual or personal property. The wife is the trustee of her husband's property. Specifically, part of the tradition states, she will preserve her own property and the property of her husband, which in my opinion means the property they jointly possess. In other words, and in our own jargon, in housekeeping, the woman must not be a spendthrift. Generosity within the family means giving from Hatam's pocket, especially considering the fact that in Islamic system, it is the husband who earns a living and the wife who must be the housekeeper. Naturally, the one who does not exert any effort in acquiring money does not know the value of money well. As far as common property which is in the family is concerned, the woman is a trustee, and if she accounts for even a single cent and does not take it for herself, this is something praiseworthy. Thus, miserliness in this context is not miserliness as a personal trait. It rather means miserly or miserly behavior, not in connection with her property, but with her husband's property. And this is not limited to the wife only, rather it is applicable to anybody else. The Commander of the Faithful, peace be with him, was foremost in generosity as well as in parsimony. History bears witness to this. He was extremely generous and kind with respect to his own property, and extremely miserly with respect to the property entrusted to him, for example, the public treasury. He was not willing to give even a single coin from the public treasury to his brother Aqil. Does it mean that Imam Ali, peace be with him, had two contradictory traits? As a disposition, the two were not opposites. To set off and work hard, to acquire war booty, or construct a subterranean canal, and even to acquire money through menial labor and to give it to others is generosity. To have meticulous custody of the public treasury of the Muslims, and even to put out the candle belonging to the public treasury when engaged in personal business, is trustworthiness and not miserliness. While busy accounting for the public treasury, and a candle belonging to the treasury was a light, some individuals would come with a personal transaction not related to the public treasury, and he would immediately extinguish the candle. "Why did you put it out?" the Imam, peace be with him, would be asked. So he would reply, "This candle belongs to the public treasury, and your purpose in coming here is something personal which is not related to the former." So they would say, "He was such a poor miser. He refrained from using a candle." This is not so. If Imam Ali, peace be with him, were really such, then we have to recognize the third caliph, Uthman, as a very benevolent and generous person for irregularly spending the public treasury of the Muslims here and there. In relation to a property entrusted to him or her, every person must be miser in the sense that he or she must behave miserly and not to be miser as a trait. This has nothing to do with disposition. As such, this tradition, which means three definite traits of woman, vanity, timidity, and miserliness, explaining them in different ways regarding man and woman, has no contradiction with the principle of moral universality. Regarding timidity, or shyness, we have said that its opposite is bravery, strength of the heart, and courage, which are desirable for man and woman. As a trait, timidity, or cowardice / shyness, is bad for man and woman, and bravery is good for both of them. Courage and the defense of truth. We have two types of defense in Islam. One is the defense of haqq, in the sense of the truth, and the other is the defense of the haqq, in the sense of social rights. Whenever certain rights are trampled upon in society, to enjoin what is good and to forbid what is evil, or to campaign against indecencies and to promote and propagate what is considered wholesome by Islam, must be undertaken. One of the reasons why bravery as a trait is not limited to the man is this. Does defending the haqq in the sense of defending the truth, or in other words, enjoining what is good and forbidding what is evil, pertain only to men? Or is it something common for both men and women? One of the conditions of enjoining the good and forbidding the evil is bravery and strength of heart. A timid person cannot engage in this social campaign. The text of the Holy Quran does not limit enjoining what is good and forbidding what is evil simply to men. In Surah Tawbah, chapter 9, verse 71, it states, "But the faithful, men and women, are comrades of one another. They bid what is right and forbid what is wrong." Faithful men and women are comrades of one another, and to be more precise, they are protectors and guardians, awliya, of one another. But the protection is based upon the Islamic principles and not personal inclinations. The same expression which is used in this following tradition: each of you is a shepherd, and each of you is responsible toward his flock. All are shepherds of one another. We have said time and time again that wali does not basically mean friend. It means protection and guardianship. Sometimes wali is an active participle adjective, meaning guardian, and at times it is passive participle adjective, meaning guarded one. It is upon the paradigm of fa'il in Arabic lexicon that it means an active agent, fa'il, as well as a passive agent, maf'ul. وَلَا مُؤْمِنُونَ وَلَا الْمُؤْمِنَاتُ بَعْدَهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْدٍ. The faithful men and women are guardians of one another. Whenever بعد وبعد is used in the Quran, it makes no distinction between the two parties, and we have many instances of it regarding men and women, such as in this verse, in Surah Nisa, the woman, chapter 4, verse 34, it states, "Men are the managers of women because of the advantage Allah has granted some of them over others." In an article by Mr. Musawi Zanjani, which I read, he mentioned a very good point. He wrote that the Quran says, because of the advantage Allah has granted some of them over others. And it does not say, because of the advantage Allah has granted men over women. It wants to say that it is because of the advantages that some have over others. It is because of the totality of advantages of man in one aspect over woman, and that of woman in another aspect over man, that the responsibility of management lies on man. It is a very exact expression, and perhaps it necessitates more explanation. The faithful men and women are protectors, shepherd and guardians of one another. In doing what? In enjoining what is good and forbidding what is evil. Hence, in defending the truth, there is no difference between men and women, and the primary condition of every act of defense is bravery, strength of heart, and courage. Courage and the defense of social rights. In defending the haqq in the sense of defending social rights, which is a definitive principle in Islam, again, according to the jurists, it is limited to either man or woman. In Surah Nisa, or the woman, chapter 4, verse 148, it states, "Allah does not like the disclosure of anyone's evil conduct in speech, except by someone who has been wronged." The word man, who, in man zulima, who has been wronged, is not specific to men or women. The same is true with another verse which pertains to the poet and poetry. In Surah Shu'ara, chapter 26, verse 226 to 27, it states, "As for the poets, only the perverse follow them. Have you not regarded that they rove in every valley, and that they say what they do not do? Bearing those who have faith and do righteous deeds, and remember Allah greatly, and aid each other after they have been wronged." The Quran is against shi'r in the sense of daydreaming and a means of stupefaction and amusement of individuals. In other words, Islam is against illusory poetry or poems which are merely for amusement and stupefaction and have truly corrupting elements. Yet, the Holy Prophet, peace be with him, and his progeny has said, "There is indeed wisdom in some poetry." Islam is not against versified words, per se. There may be some wisdom in a poem. In that case, that poem is a poem in that sense. The Quran reproaches the poets at that time, and in most cases the poets are like that. From among them can be found a few principled poets like Iqbal Lahori, who composed poetry to advance their sublime objectives and not to utilize it as an art devoid of any orientation and direction. The Quran states, "Have you not regarded that they rove in every valley, and that they say what they do not do?" One day they praise this person, and on another day they praise another person. One day they would deal with this subject and another subject on another day. One day they would praise a thing and condemn it on another day. This is the epitome of the lack of principle. The exception are those poets who have faith. In our jargon, the principled ones are those whose orientation is to make use of their poetry at the service of their faith. Nowadays, the existentialists talk about committed literature and committed poetry. The Quran more or less deals with the same subject. It is against poetry with the exception of committed poetry. Bearing those who have faith and do righteous deeds and remember Allah greatly and aid each other after they have been wronged. That is, except those who have been wronged and are seeking help and assistance through poetry. They compose poetry in order to incite people to rise up against oppression. Here, the Quranic expression is also absolute and universal, and it is not limited to either men or women. Also, it is recorded in the Peak of Eloquence, or Nahjul Balagha, that the Commander of the Faithful, peace be with him, has said, "The ignoble cannot ward off oppression and right cannot be achieved without effort." In the words of the Usulis, it is a universal premise which negates exclusionism. The Usulis have a very elegant and excellent statement. They say that most of the universal or general premises have exceptions. We mention a rule or law, and then we mention an exception to it. But some universal or general premises entertain no exception. That is, essentially, its tone, logic, and mode seem to declare, I do not accept any exception. Basically, exception has no meaning for me. The courage of Fatimatu Zahra, peace be with her. The universal premise in this context is something that does not accept any exception, negating any form of exclusionism. Its best and most illustrious basis is the historical account of Hazrat Zahra and Hazrat Zainab, peace be with them. From one perspective, the account of Hazrat Zahra, peace be with her, was indeed strange and extraordinary. Take it into consideration as a whole. On one hand, Imam Ali and Fatimatu Zahra, peace be with them, were a couple who showed that in terms of material wealth and possession, they were unconcerned with the world and its contents. Imam Ali, peace be with him, said, What shall I do, fadak or no fadak, while tomorrow this body is to go into the grave? Essentially, what Ali, peace be with him, has to do with fadak. The one who is firm in the world, what has he to do with fadak? The one who escaped from any cause, what has he to do with fortune? The Imam, peace be with him, was a person who turned away from different dimensions of the world. As a source of money, wealth, and income, they had really shown that they were needless of fadak. On the other hand, it was one of the indisputable facts of Islamic history, and the Ahl Sunnah have narrated this famous tradition more, that on his deathbed, the Holy Prophet made Fatimatu Zahra cry more. The Holy Prophet whispered something to Fatimatu Zahra, and she cried more. He then whispered another thing to her, and it made her smile. Later on, she was asked about the two things whispered to her, and she said, In the first whisper, my father informed me that definitely he shall soon leave the world. I cried because of the separation from him. In the second whisper, he told me that I will soon join him. That was the source of my joy. Moreover, we know that the Holy Messenger was so ill that he was bedridden. He was certain that he would soon depart from this world. In such a situation, he brought forth the status of Fadak after him. As a property, Fadak had no value for Zahra, peace be with her. But as a usurped right, and that right must be fought for, it became so valuable for her that along with some women of Banu Hashim and other lady supporters, she came to the mosque of Medina in the presence of the caliph of the time, delivering the sermon with such eloquence, thereby crushing the other party and defending her own right. Why was she not afraid? Was it contrary to the Islamic training? Was it unbecoming, for example, for a lady to do so? Was it an obscene act for a lady to come to the mosque of Medina in the presence of thousands of people and talk about material wealth and defend her right? No, it was not obscene at all. It was the defense of her right. As a vanguard of the truth and that the truth should not be sacrificed and the precedent of trampling upon the right should not be established, the same Zahra who was heedless of the world and its contents as possession, material affair, personal wealth, and source of individual enjoyment, and the same Zahra who was certain that she would soon depart from the world, and when a person knows that she will die soon, her craving for material possessions of the world will be totally lost, would come with utmost bravery and defend her right. She personally came to the house of the caliph of the time and made this demand. Thereafter, it was taken from her by force, and then she came to the presence of the commander of the faithful, Imam Ali, peace be with him, in the mosque of Medina, and something unbelievable took place. At the end of the day, she was forced to confront them, and indeed formally opposed them. The courage of Hazrat Zainab, peace be with her. Or, take as another example the account of Zainab, peace be with her. If timidity as a moral trait or quality were good for a lady, then Hazrat Zainab must have been more timid and shy than any other woman, and idiomatically, she would come out of her shell. Could one be compelled to deliver a speech? Or was there anyone in the court of Ibn Ziyad who forced Zainab to confront Ibn Ziyad in such a way and even warn him of the real danger of him and his bunch getting killed? Something more impressive happened in the court of Yazid. Given its pomp and fuss, It was different from the court of Ibn Ziyad. Firstly, Ibn Ziyad was only a governor and Yazid was the caliph. Secondly, Ibn Ziyad was in Kufa and Yazid was in Sham, and on account of its proximity to Byzantine, the then Constantinople, Sham had a distinct splendor. Under the pretext of the need for preserving the outward glory of Islam, Muawiyah had made the court in Sham the court of Caesar, Khosrow, and Sultan. As recorded in history, there were intricate palaces with intricate doors with assigned guards. There were golden chairs on which ambassadors and nobles were seated. It was an extraordinary assembly, full of magnificence. Yet this lady did not pay attention to all these things. She said to Yazid, "You are too despicable and insignificant for me to address, and you do not deserve to be my interlocutor." Can a timid woman do this? No. Her life must have been in danger, but that was what she was least concerned about. Her honor and dignity were not endangered. On the contrary, this act of bravery added to her honor and dignity. Therefore, this difference is related to a specific condition that a woman has. Moreover, this difference has to do with behavior and not to character and personality. In terms of moral personality, there is no difference between men and women. And we know for a fact that if a man is also in a situation wherein he carries a social trust, and he wants to keep this trust, then there is no room for mercy or bravery. There is no room for a humble gesture. Whenever there is a trust, it is the time for the gesture of dignity, circumspection, and not taking risks. End of chapter 9.